What did he fear? It was not fear or dread. It was a nothing that he knew too well. It was all a nothing, and a man was nothing too. It was only that, and light was all it needed, and a certain cleanness and order. Some lived in it and never felt it, but he knew it all was nada y pues nada y nada y pues nada. Our nada who art in nada, nada be thy name, thy kingdom nada, thy will be nada in nada as it is in nada. Give us this nada our daily nada, and nada us our nada as we nada our nadas, and nada us into nada, but deliver us from nada, pues nada. Hail nothing full of nothing, nothing is with thee. He smiled and stood before a bar with a shining steam pressure coffee machine.
What's yours? Asked the barman.
Nada. Hey, this is David.
And this is Nick. And welcome back to another episode of the Books of Some Substance podcast, where we're continuing Hemingway Short Story Month. This time we're talking about A Clean, Well-Lighted Place. It's a very short story in which an old man is sitting, getting drunk in a very clean, well-lit cafe. So this is actually kind of one of my favorites of his in like anything that we've read. So I'm just going to kind of jump right into, I love the structure of this story because it's basically a guy sitting, he's getting drunk, and other people observing him. And it's this different way of doing sort of an unreliable narrator. You have two waiters who are just conversing, patching together rumors they've heard of this man and why he's here and why his life is sort of empty. And just the structure of that already, as I was reading it, I was like, man, this just comes across as like a good conversation, but it's actually quite an efficient and clever way of delivering a story. So I don't know, did you pick up on that? Or obviously you picked up on that. Did you enjoy that?
Oh, I love it. I think this is one of Hemingway's best stories, which makes it one of the best stories ever written. Hemingway has such a great way of telling a story through dialogue, which in turn reveals so much about the characters having the conversation as well. So even though we get that unreliability through them as their conversation progresses, we also get those characters drawn out in such a way that you can't, I mean, you can get it through just narrative exposition, but it's not as fun, I think, as a reader. It's not as interesting. You do less work picking out who these people are, why they're having this conversation, what their conversation means, how they relate to each other. And it's all done in such a short amount of time.
Yeah, it's like every line is kind of like triple encoded, right? You get something about the person being observed. You get something about the person who's speaking. You get something about, you know, who that line is being delivered to.
Hmm.
And there's even, I mean, just this section where they're talking about, so old man, he's about 80, rumored to be very rich and had previously tried to hang himself, but his niece sort of cut him down is what they said.
Hmm.
And they were talking about why the old man tried to kill himself. And the waiter goes, he was in despair. And the other one goes, what about? And he replies, nothing. Just so much of that is kind of, it's playful, but it's also kind of the most heavy thing of all time. Like, what are you in despair about? Nothing.
Yeah, because nothing is such a quick throwaway response, meaning like, I don't really know sometimes. Like, I don't know, nothing. Nothing in particular, maybe. But It's actually very specific, or at least it is. It at least triggers it in the older waiter's mind, who does go off on that Padre Nuestro de Nada sort of prayer at the end.
Yeah, and as he weaves, so he kind of, he's like, he's planting these little seeds of nothing and then getting into nadaing your way through the Lord's Prayer as a means of basically, like, so the line that you read in there, but it was all a nothing and a man was nothing too, is just like, oh my God, that's just like a punch to the gut. And then to continue that through kind of weaving in, you know, what I understand to be kind of the equivalent of Spanish, like so anyway, or an or just kind of a filler, but it also ties back to nothing. And then you're just kind of splicing it into, again, like a prayer. It's just such an existential thing about how kind of nothing really matters other than having a nice, reliable routine and a clean spot to sit down when you have insomnia.
Yeah.
You know?
And in a way, too, this also is a story about not only that perception of nothingness, but I think that nothingness is perceived by the older men in the story as a way of commenting on age. So like the young waiter, he's in a rush. He wants to get home, right? He wants to get home to see his wife, but not too early in case he finds her in bed with somebody else, which is a little in joke that the waiters make to each other. But, and then you have the older waiter who sort of empathizes and sympathizes with this old blind drunk who just wants a place to sit, doesn't want to be home, doesn't want to be in bed, or can't be even. And so you see the sort of maturity, but maturity in a direction of, I don't want to say, not indifference, but in negativity almost.
Yeah, and I mean, I think the last paragraph is worth reading. It's, you know, so it's about that older waiter. And it says, he disliked bars and bodegas. A clean, well-lighted cafe was a very different thing. Now, without thinking further, he would go home to his room. He would lie in the bed, and finally, with daylight, he would go to sleep. After all, he said to himself, it is probably only insomnia. Many must have it.
Yeah, it's probably only insomnia. Such a smart line. Because as a reader, you know it's not, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And even if you do have like kind of full-blown insomnia, that's a big deal too.
Yeah, and it's not, that's just a symptom of something greater, usually.
Yeah. So you get this portrait of multiple people at the same time, and they're all struggling with this big unnamed something.
Which is nothing.
Yeah, the big joke of it, it's nothing at all. Or it is this huge nothing. And
the nothing.
Just the play on the words throughout all of that. That again, that like that part's like double coded as well. And it just this one really, I just feel is like the most amount of information you can put into things in the available like number of lines of the story. It's
well,
just so condensed.
Yeah, you just brought up, and granted, this is not what this episode is about, but the possible short story that Hemingway wrote sitting at a restaurant. I'm sure you've heard this story.
And if the baby shoes, right?
Yeah. And according to some other author, I can't remember who, Hemingway was sitting around at a restaurant with a bunch of other authors and critics and whatnot. And he said, I bet you all the money you have in your pocket, put it on the table. I can create an entire story in 6 words. They put the money on the table. He wrote on a napkin, for sale, baby shoes, never worn. I think that's the line. I'd have to look that up.
Yeah.
But which I don't know if that's true or if it's an apocryphal tale, but I can believe it after reading this.
Yeah, it just has that again. We'll reference the last week's episode of the Hemingway punch, right? The moral that happens in the end, that we're all struggling with this thing, or just the purity of emotion, or, you know, just that weight of it. And again, it still has some of the small, like, little witty things, like you said, the in-jokes between the waiters. Mm. And then it's just, I think every line is not worth throwing out. And, like, I even kind of started a thing where, so the waiter who's trying to get him to leave early, he goes up and says, finished, he said, speaking with that omission of syntax stupid people employ when talking to drunken people or foreigners. No more tonight. Close now. Another, said the old man.
that paragraph feels like a dig. Like,
because
Hemingway, this story takes place in Spain, and there's little hints along the way that it takes place in another country, and they're speaking in a different language. He's just sort of rendering it in English, which is also an interesting little method that he does, right?
Yeah.
So you see, like, the little lines, like, he left a half a pesada tip, and in other lines like that. But that paragraph seems like a dig. After people, I'm sure, have treated Hemingway this way as a foreigner and a drunk in a foreign country, you know?
Of which he, I believe, was for large portions of his time. A drunk, that is.
And a foreigner.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's kind of like a For Whom the Bell Tolls thing that I noticed. I'd read that a couple months ago. And just his ability to sort of address the elephant in the room, which is this story is taking place in a different country. And very clearly, everything would be happening in a different language, but very clearly, I'm writing in English. So I need to weave these things together, but also at the same time, and it's more of like an amplified thing in For Whom the Bell Tolls, but changing some of the verbiage such that it feels like almost a different kind of English, such that it feels like it might be a different language that you're reading. You know, in you know, For Whom the Bell Tolls, which I'm referencing multiple times, but he uses lots of thys and stuff like that. So there's almost like a majestic quality. And I don't get it as much in this, but there's kind of like a sharpness or just like, I don't know, I can't put my finger on exactly like the method, but you don't in any way question that this is authentically a story happening in a different place. And I think part of it, like you said, weaving in the correct, Spanish terms, and certainly the paragraph at the beginning that you read that kind of caps it all together. But he's just, he bridges that gap better than I think a lot of people. And I think that's why some of his stories, despite the feeling that, you know, sort of in modern times that maybe you're not supposed to be writing about things that you don't know directly, sort of the write what you know sort of feeling, stick to your own language, stick to your own character, stick to your own kind of background. And I think that's why some of his stories still feel super real to me. He's got a quality of writing that preserves the idea that this could be somewhere else, even though he is an American in a foreign country. I also just love the line when the when the waiter goes up to the deaf man, he's trying to get him to leave, and he's just like, "You should have killed yourself last week," he said to the deaf man. The old man motioned with his finger. "A little more," he said. It's also a lesson that if you're doing a podcast and you're talking about some sort of undefinable, you know, writing trait, that you should just go back to all the funny lines about suicide.
Yes.
So join us next week as we reconvene to continue Hemingway Short Story Month, where we're talking about his short Hills Like White Elephants.